We discuss about the deduction of the Lagrangian equation from the Hamilton principle. And today we are going to derive the Lagrangian equation from Hamilton principle. So the question is, what is the difference between the deduction and the derivation? Derivation means we will start with the ab initio. Ab initio means the basic principle, and then go step by step to conclude something in term of some equation that is called derivation. And deduction means we use the standard equation and directly we substitute or we apply them some, you can say, some standard condition, and then we deduce something. So in the last lecture we applied the Hamilton principle and then we derive the Lagrange equation of motion. And today again we apply the Hamilton principle, but we start with the basic definition and then we again derive the Lagrange equation of motion. So as we know our previous knowledge that the Lagrangian is the function of the generalized coordinate and generalized velocity, and one more factor that is called time. So some of you are interested to know about the fact that if the position is known, then why this velocity is required, and if it is, then we consider that if there is capital N number of particle, then 3n minus p number of degree of freedom is required to describe the system. So here again we have f that is 3n minus p, and we have f number of position coordinate, f number of velocity coordinate, and one more that is t. So here we require three two okay 2f plus 1 degree means number of coordinate. But this is not true. If we have f number of coordinate, then simply we take the derivative, then we get the velocity, and okay, time is there. This is not a very big problem because time is maybe explicitly or implicitly appear in the Lagrangian. If we consider explicitly, then the Lagrangian depend upon only qi and qi dot, means L Lagrangian is the function of a generalized coordinate and generalized velocity. Here we consider the Lagrangian doesn't depend upon the time explicitly. Now, if we want to find out slight change in the Lagrangian, which is possible, either there is some change in the position coordinate or there is some change in the velocity coordinate, then delta, the small change in the Lagrangian is equal to the change in Lagrangian with respect to position coordinate. Means if there is a change in delta qi in the position coordinate, then the change in the position Lagrangian is equal to curly L by delta qi. This is the variation in L with respect to qi, and this is the variation in L with respect to qi dot. So if we integrate both sides with respect to time from time t1 to t2, then here we apply this integration here, integration here, and then we apply the basic principle that is called Hamilton principle. So according to Hamilton principle, that delta variation in the Lagrangian over time t2 and t1 is equal to 0. So we apply Lagrangian principle. So this is again after the application of Lagrangian principle, we simply substitute the value of L here and L here. Now come on this second term. In this second term, this is the product of two terms, curly L by curly QK dot and delta QK dot and delta QK dot. QK dot means we can write this is d by dt of delta Q. D by dt of delta Q. So we can write this delta QK dot as d by dt of delta QK dot. And this is d by dt of delta qk into my dt. So keeping the first term as it is, we integrate this second term, and this is the product of two term, that's why we apply the integration by part. And according to this principle, the first term is as it is, integration of second term, and minus integration of derivative of the second first term and integration of second term. So we get these two terms. So now this term is the central term. This central term is equal to zero. And why this is equal to 0? Because we are considering the variation in the position, generalized position at the extremum. Extremum means at the end point. And we know at point the variation is equal to 0. Because we assume that the system is starting from A and go to B, and at A initially we consider the velocity is equal to 0, system is at rest, and again the at point B the system comes to rest with 0 velocity, there is no change in the position, that's why we consider these are extremum. So this delta Q variation at time t1 and t2 is equal to 0, and if it is, if we put the upper limit and then lower limit, then 0 minus 0 comes out equal to 0, so the central term become equal to 0. Okay, so we have left with these two terms. This is the first term, this is the second term, and if we combine these two terms, means if we take delta qk and dt common, delta qk and dt common, then we get this curly L by curly qk minus d by dt of curly L by curly q dot k, that is equal to 0. And we know this integration is equal to 0 if, why this is equal to 0? Okay, this left hand side is equal to 0, then there are three possibilities. Either this integrand is equal to 0, one thing. Second thing, this delta qk is equal to 0. This is the second thing. And third thing, this dt is equal to 0. So let us consider the possibility that this delta qk is not equal to 0, dt is not equal to 0. Dt is not is equal to 0 because we are in our problem, we are talking about the two times t1 and t2, and these are not equal. T1 is not equal to t2. If it is, then dt is equal to 0. And if t1 or t2 are equal, then the system is not moving. System aapka usi ek hi particular position pe hi hum do time ki baat kar rahe hain, which is not possible. So if we are talking about delta qk is the change in the position coordinate, which is means obvious. We are talking about a dynamic system. Dynamic system means the system is moving from point 1 to point 2 at time t1 and t2. And at both point t1 and t2, we consider the system is extremum. Extremum means there is no change in the position. Okay. So if system is moving from t1 to t2, means system is in dynamic motion. So after time t1, there is a slight change in the position. So there is a change in position, means we cannot say this delta qk is equal to 0. So possibility that this delta qk is equal to 0 is again not possible. Delta qk is 0 at only t1 and t2. That's why we consider here delta qk at t1 and t2 is equal to 0. But at other position in between time t1 and t2, this delta qk is not equal to 0. So again, we ruled out the possibility of this delta qk is equal to 0. So we have left with only this integrand is equal to 0. So this integrand is equal to 0. This is equal to 0, where means d by dt of curly L by curly q dot k minus curly L by curly qk is equal to 0. And where the k have possible value from 1 to f, where f is the degree of freedom, its value is equal to 3n minus p, where n is the number of particles which constitute the system. So these set of equation, why this is called set of equation, because this is for k, for kth particle, and we have k possible value of k is equal to 1 to f. So we have actually f number of equation, that's why this is called set of equation. So this set of equation is called Lagrange equation of motion for a conservative system, means we can define these equation only in term of conservative system. If the system is non-conservative in nature, then we cannot say this Lagrange equation of motion can be used to find the information about the system of particle, like acceleration, velocity and coordinate. So it is very necessary condition that the force system should be conservative in nature. This is the one thing. The second thing is we have two different approach. One is called Newtonian approach or Newton method to determine the information about the system of particle. And the second is the Hamiltonian approach. So the question is, which one is the most important, or which one is simpler to use, and which one is superior over another? So as far as a single particle is concerned, the Newton law of motion provide a very simpler method to describe a system of particle. But when we have a large number of particle, then capital means large number of equation is required, which is very difficult to solve, to find the information about the system of particle. In that case, we go for the Hamilton principle, and then we go for the Lagrange equation of motion. So here we are, we have some comparison between the Lagrangian and the Newtonian approach, and these two approaches are equally important, but may be applicable in case, in different cases. So as we already have discussed, when we have single particle, Newtonian approach is significant, or you can say important, but for a large number of particle, we go for the Lagrangian approach. But there are some point, or you can say some important fact about the Lagrangian approach, which make it superior over the Newtonian approach. So Lagrangian equation of motion are invariant in the form with respect to transformation of coordinate. So transformation of coordinate means we have three type of coordinate system, like a coordinate system, parametric system, that is called also called the spherical system, and the third one is the cylindrical system. So in when we convert one system into another system, then there is a change in the equation in case we are using the Newtonian approach. But it is very simple to use in case of Lagrangian equation of motion, because these are invariant. आपकी जो form है equation की वो change नहीं होगी. आप as we discuss कि हम this 2.27 represent the Lagrangian equation. तो Q K may be आपका x हो, y हो, z हो, आपका थीटा हो, r हो, phi हो, u, या आपका जो cylindrical coordinate system के case में r theta or after z, in all cases the equation remains same. But if we talking about the Newtonian physics, then the means equation become, there will be a change in the equation that we use to find out or to solve a system of equation. The second thing is motion of a system of particle is expressed by energy in case of Lagrangian approach. As we discussed, we use the Lagrangian means L is equal to T minus V, that is the kinetic energy and the potential energy. So we have to deal only with the energy, not with the, you can say, the position coordinate, velocity coordinate, acceleration coordinate, force coordinate, like that. We are not discussing about these different parameters. We are discussing the all things only in terms of energy. That's why this is very important to use this Lagrangian approach. The third one is in case of Lagrangian, we use the energy, and we know energy is a scalar quantity, while in case of Newtonian physics we use the position, velocity, force, and these are the vector quantity. And it is very easy to work with a scalar quantity as compared to a vector quantity, because when we are dealing with a vector quantity, then extra effort, or you can say extra attention, has to be given on the direction, about the direction of that particular quantity. Aapko direction ko explain karne ke liye additional equation chahiye, but in case of scalar, we do not have to panic about the direction of that particular quantity. That's why it is easy to work with a scalar quantity, and that's why it is easy to work or use this, you can say, Lagrangian approach. Also, Lagrangian equation are expressed in generalized coordinate. Generalized coordinate ki term mein hum express kar sakte hain, and generalized coordinate means coordinate in term of general expression. We are not going about exact position or position or displacement of actual particle, one means for each particle. We use the generalized things. Generalized hum expression use karte hain. Ab har ek particle ke liye we use this position and velocity for individual particle, then we have to use a large number of equations, which become very difficult. Okay, so in this respect, we can say the Lagrangian equation of motion is slightly easy to use. Usko hum easily use kar sakte hain, and but every means this equation, this approach also have some disadvantage, and today we are not going to discuss the disadvantage of this Lagrangian approach over Newtonian approach. So today I am stop here. This is from Lagrangian equation of motion from you can say